Hi, welcome to the 2022 launch vehicle number 4 airframe handoff. So this is ostensibly the last thing you guys have to do before you leave, before we fail you, so you have to come back next year. I'm going to turn it over. Why don't we do a quick round of introductions, which we forgot to do last time. Who's on the team, who's here, and sort of maybe a little bit about what you were in charge of, if you guys did have things that you were in charge of.
Hi, I'm P7port. I model the pass-through covers, the end cap, various other small things. I mostly did the cab this time, and I also did some hand calcs.
Grant.
Oh, and the grant. That's rather important.
Yep. The YouTube.
Yes.
Hi, I'm Rebecca Duschuk, and I was co-lead for FEA, and I did the media, the videos for the capstone.
Hello, I'm Brandon, and I'm the manager on team, I guess. I sort of worked on developing a workflow for the team so that it was easier to delegate tasks and stuff, and then I myself worked on some FBA tasks and worked on the video with Becca and helped out on deliverables.
I'm Hayden. I was the team lead. I did pretty much everything. I had my hand in everything. And,
through that. That's it.
Cool. And we've got David, who's not really listening because he's the dirty electrical, and Max and Jay in the room as well. And who's online? Joe and, oh, Davis, sorry. Davis, you go because you're part of the team.
Yeah. So I did, I guess, isogrid analysis and design and optimization. That was my key contribution, but yeah.
And I guess, mentioning the other teammates, we did have Liana Kobielinski. She did a lot of the thermal FEA on Isotank, and we also had Steve Hines, who did the design on kind of the testing structure.
Okay. So what would be great is a quick review of sort of the requirements and how you guys got started, and then go into where we're currently at with CAD and then eventually at the very end, we'll go through and go through all your documents so that we see it and we've got it captured here. Oh, fucking A. Oh, good, I am recording, sorry. sorry, I didn't see the recording thing. Let's start over, everybody start over.
He does that much.
Although I do have to say, the amount of F-bombs dropped in this will be nowhere near the number of F-bombs dropped in the Orsat Live handoff, which I think has the actual record now for that, for a capstone handoff.
Right, see how fast we get this to modify.
So that we'll go through all of the places that you guys have stored things and just get that, capture that, and go for the next team and then go from there. And then some requirements. People online, if you can't hear us, let us know. I've got the talkie puck, but the other people may be faint.
So before we dig into the requirements set at the beginning, I just want to comment that I think the scope of the project from before we started changed pretty drastically. So we'll talk about the requirements that were given to us, and then we'll talk about how we sort of changed the direction of the project with Andrew's approval for the most part. And begrudging approval.
Yeah, absolutely. All right, go.
Okay, so basically we were a legacy capstone from last year's LV4 capstone. Last year did a lot of the preliminary CAD, and as well as kind of carrying over a lot of the carbon fiber designs from LV3. We were tasked at the very beginning to basically do actual analysis and I guess like physical testing of this, all those kinds of things. And then we decided that carbon fiber sucks, and we decided to switch everything to isogrid. So a lot of the modules and stuff kind of changed, but we still kept a lot of the key things as like the coupling rings, obviously the entire like modularity of the rocket. We did do some physical testing and designed infrastructure that could kind of accommodate more physical testing in the future. But a lot of the stuff, I guess, on here has changed. So I guess, yeah, I don't know if you want to go, I can turn my camera on and see what you'd like.
Yeah, I promise that I've got the microphone. Got the puck,
So I guess should we go?
Can you make your screen 150%?
Yes.
Ooh, someone else uses Firefox.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, sorry. Go back to control zero it back to regular size.
Control zero.
Yep. And then go to the 100% drop down and go to 150. Yeah.
How do I get rid of this? That's what I want.
Yeah, there you go.
Trust me, guys. I've used it before.
And then get rid of the left hand thing.
Left hand thing?
Go back, scroll back, and just get rid of the table on the left. Yeah.
Oh, sure, sure.
Okay. Awesome. Thank you.
All right. So I guess this was the big table that was kind of decided for us. We wanted to do axial testing on our coupling rings as well as our composite modules. We wanted to do failure testing on the composite modules, which I guess translating out to IceGrid, we did do that. Coupling ring axial test, we did design stuff for that, and that's all kind of currently in manufacturing. So that is ready to be done as soon as that's done. And if any of us are hanging around when it is done, we should be able to knock that out. Vibration testing, I think literally from the meeting last night, we kind of decided that was iffy, that we wouldn't really get any good results. IceGrid fuel tank, we didn't really end up touching that honestly at all, just because that was kind of parallel path over at Peter's place. We had Rebecca and Brandon go up to one of the hydrostatic tests, but we kind of left that alone for the domain up there, the Washington domain. Something big that I guess we learned going through some of the just learning about how they axial, how they test rockets. They don't do bending tests as far as I'm aware. They test bending to equivalent loads. And so like pull up paint, I can show you guys the lecture that I specifically saw this in, but you have your little cylinder here, you have your axial loading from the front, and then basically you have a bending moment that creates this side and this side. And basically when you're gonna test it to equivalency, you would just add these two together, and then that would be your equivalent load that you test the module in your compression form. That is what I was aware of how they do that kind of stuff. So we didn't really go for a bending test or anything like that. So some more information, I can link you to
the
lecture.
How do they put the bending moment on there then? Like where is that?
Well, they don't. It's literally just compression. So they basically just take, it's like a vector addition thing, right?
So so they just off axis it a little bit? Is that, I mean, how do they actually do that?
They just don't
do that. So when you have a bending moment, like your fibers on the left are going to be in tension and the fibers on the right are in compression, right? Yep. So you your worst case compression is the stack up of axial compression and bending compression. So you just tested at that worst case compression load.
Oh, so they literally don't.
Yeah, literally don't.
God, you guys, what's wrong with you?
This is the aerospace standard. But part of our philosophy was that if we wanted to build FEA procedures that we could accurately predict like compression failure.
Yeah.
And then we can use those same procedures to test it in bending with FEA. That was what our philosophy was.
Okay.
So we have one data point that was pretty good because we've only tested one IceGrid module. Okay. So I think that we should probably do at least one or two more to see if that
was there. Was there a corresponding tension test?
Not yet, but that's something that we think we can and should do with our test infrastructure, which we'll get into.
Okay, cool.
I guess where do we want to go from here?
Excellent. So then, so this is, so go scroll up for just a minute.
Sure.
So we had you do a module ring subsystem, the composite module, pass through ring, IceGrid fuel tank. You guys screwed it all up and you've got a module ring subsystem and now everything's IceGrid. We have zero composite modules because you hate our freedoms. And pass-through rings, we have new pass-through rings. And the IceGrid fuel tank, you guys did but weren't really in charge of. So it's in CAD, right?
Oh, what do you mean?
So the IceGrid fuel tanks are in CAD, correct?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, okay.
And we did do analysis on all these subsystems. We just didn't also do physical testing.
Talking about physical testing. Okay.
Yeah.
So that's great. So really the only change is composite to IceGrid modules in terms of the
stack up of stuff.
Yeah.
And that kind of has things that cascade as in like the pass-through modules are within the IceGrid modules and stuff.
Right.
So, but yeah, basically.
Excellent. And you did not, of the shoulds, the composite nose cone, you guys did not touch, did not work on launch logs as far as I know.
We kind of don't know where to go with that.
That's perfectly fine.
Yeah.
No, yeah. Not, well, no, so launch logs changed because the their old launch logs were a requirement of base 11. And since we think we're not launching under base 11, those can be completely redesigned. So we agreed to backburner it until the launch system got developed further. Nosecone we left alone because ERS was developing, recovery was developing a whole new system, and we didn't know if they were going to change the nose. So we left that for future development.
And then bulkhead though, didn't you do the bulkheads?
We manufactured one. We did plenty of FEA, but testing
we did
the infrastructure being done.
That's right.
Yeah, we complete redesign on the bulkhead. And we are prepared to test that shortly after, sometime this summer, I believe, or fall at the latest.
We had a few like big design changes and a few of these things. I don't know if you want to go through those specifically in CAD, if that's the best way to do it.
I think we should go through CAD now. Like, show us what the hell you guys did for 6 months.
Okay. well, we could start maybe with, I don't know if you guys have a preference on a rocket or the testing.
Do you want to actually pull up the report? The report real quick, because not the report, but the poster, because I think that has some good images.
For everything but that, man.
Because that's got a good comparison of what we were given versus what we've got.
Got it. I suppose I could unravel the real poster in the rock room here, but
is this all rolled up?
Yeah.
We could unroll it.
The room.
What would you specifically like to see, Davis?
I guess just wanted to show maybe the on the left and scroll up, the second column. Yeah, sure. The isogrid design. Right. So I guess just to cover that. So that was like on the left is our sort of the legacy design, where we have the green is the composite module. Top and bottom is the pass through ring. Those where those squares are. And then there's a ring of arc clamps connecting them. Is this helpful?
Yep.
To look at, okay.
The general kind of thing that we did is we just, by making that whole thing into one, we eliminated arc clamps, coupling rings, this whole kind of section here that was like solid aluminum, which is very, weight expensive. And then also simplifying the pass down to isogrid also significantly reduces a lot of weight. And just you have a whole module now that you just put all your crap into. And that's basically the design philosophy that we took on that.
Most importantly, you called the yellow triangles nachos.
Yes.
Space nachos.
Yeah.
Yep. Good.
Yeah.
Future capstones have to get the front end in yellow.
Yeah, absolutely. You created yellow. And then since you're here already, move off to the right and talk about the CAD, just an overview before we get into CAD.
Of this guy?
Yeah.
Sure. So that's our testing infrastructure. It's meant to test actual flight hardware. We're able to test arc clamps in the middle there in tension, as well as a bulkhead by replacing that top piece right there. And I guess any kind of other thrust plans or anything else that might want to go there. Specifically, if you wanted to, and you put a really giant ass spacer in here, you can also just put a flight module in the tension area there, and you just have a set of arc clamps on top and on bottom, then you could test the whole module in tension.
Right.
Just to clarify, I don't think you mentioned it, is that if you look at the section cut view on the right, and there's that big L shape, that is a hydraulic ram that bolts to the bottom and pushes on the top. So
Steve called it the water goat.
Water goat. Okay. But yeah, we can put in a much longer pusher on the top. Oh, the rectangle that's closest to the top there is a load cell so that we can actually take measurements of what the load is when things fail. And everything's modular. There's a pretty high factor of safety on the test infrastructure itself so that any yielding should be happening within the flight parts and the test infrastructure is fully reusable.
And should be said that is the machine shop's hydraulic ramp.
Machine shops are competence?
It's in the machine shop.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Good to know.
So, anyway.
Okay.
Yeah. That's that. I don't know if we want to go into.
I just have a comment on this. I was very impressed with this design. I'm really happy to where you all got to on this, and the fact that we're able to use the kind of same stock material as what we're going to be using for the airframe. I think that brought in a lot of cost efficiencies.
Shout out Steve. He's not here, but.
Yeah, we're pretty excited about this. I can't wait to break stuff on it.
Yes.
But yeah, so I think Joe asked about testing parts and tension, but we could totally, you know, so there's the two middle rings that have like two rows of bolts each sticking out. Those are like an arc clamp ring, but we could, or a coupling ring, sorry. So we could put a full scale module and attach it via two coupling ring arc clamps in the middle here and just put a much longer spacer on the top and test a full module on tension.
Yeah, I guess that's a good overview. I don't know if you want to specifically go into CAD then. I don't know if there's anything else in the poster here. We have isogrid optimization, which we definitely want to talk about at some point, as well as our test versus FEA stuff. But I don't know if that'd be better done after we get like an overview of stuff in CAD.
Let's do an overview of CAD and then let's dive into each of those separate things and maybe show those the section and the thing and all that kind of stuff. Sure. We're running low on time, so we got to go fast.
Yes, sounds good. So here is our airframe. Obviously everything's isogrid now. We did a lot more this year with configurations. And so a lot of these configurations, a lot of these assemblies have configurations where last year's capstone didn't. Basically what that allows you to do is just switch between triangle representations. We had some trouble getting it to load in CAD. So we had like less triangles at one point. We had 12 triangle pattern, and this is now a 24 triangle pattern, which Davis might talk about is more efficient. But we were having trouble getting this to load at first. So we had a few different configurations. But aside from that, I guess I'll go into specific modules.
Yeah, just start from the top down. Sure. Just going down.
Well, I think I guess, you're wrong folder. I think you want to go to the wrong folder. Yeah. Okay. And while he's loading, one thing I want to share that we did that was new this year is, so we have a lot of similar features that maybe go in different positions, right? Because we have the bulkhead ring and the coupling ring, and then that like the isogrid skin, and then maybe there is or isn't a pass-through ring. Maybe it swaps position with the bulkhead ring. So we modeled the coupling ring's on the top, and then you have that sort of thick flange with holes in it, and that's where the bulkhead mounts. And those are all modeled as individual parts. And then we have this configuration table says like kind of lets us rearrange those. Everything is driven by the same model. So if you update the bulkhead attachment ring, it will cascade to all the parts in the correct position where it gets used.
So it's a lot more efficient if we want to make changes, which I think is very critical for isogrid specifically, because if you have different loads, then you might have a different optimized isogrid with like different parameters and stuff like that. But like, for example, this guy right here, if you just saw it didn't have a bulkhead ring, now this one does have a bulkhead ring. And then if I would switch to this one, it would have two bulkhead rings in there. And so it's just like literally all in one file, and you can just switch between stuff and see, there you go, now you have bulkhead down there and bulkhead down there.
That is super cool.
Yeah. And so all this stuff is kind of stored in that table. For the actual parametric model here, we have everything defined, and then we have a few different parameters in this, just basically the length of the module as well as like the actual triangle parameters. This one might take forever to load because it's isogrid. This is the parametric model, so it's really like computationally intensive. And so there was something you said in last year's caps on handoff that was like, is Onshape good? And but at the same time, it takes forever to do this kind of stuff. Forever. Like you'd be sitting here for literally like 10 minutes waiting for a model to regenerate for isogrid, which can be frustrating because you're fighting the tool rather than having the tool work for you.
Yeah.
So it works, obviously. We have the CAD and everything in there, but it was frustrating. So just something to consider if it keeps going down.
Do you think that SolidWorks would have been a better tool for this capstone?
I don't know if SolidWorks gives you that sort of weird, I know I haven't dug into it, but the configuration tables and such. And one thing that's nice is we can export, if you get the entire airframe to load, you can export as a step file and then put it into SolidWorks and investigate it. So then you have a static copy that isn't being driven by these variables, and then it's really easy to load. And so maybe as certain things get locked in, they can stop being generated and become like hardwired, you know? So that's something we've discussed, but at this point when things may change, it seemed better to keep it controlled by variables.
You can't have design variables forward. Just worried about my soul.
All right.
I was going to try and load a test article here or any of the iCRM modules, because something I guess that we did that would be really good to go into is this is a complex shape. And so doing analysis on this is like super, super hard. And it just doesn't work out. And you have like a billion elements and stuff. So what we did is we made surfaces that also generate with the same parametric model. And so you can just generate a surface like this and then pop that over into FEA. So if you're, you're able to do a lot more computationally efficient stuff.
Yeah. If you're familiar with FEA at all, a 2D shape, a 3D shape and getting similar sized elements when you have these really fine variations in features, quite difficult. But by doing it as a 2D model, it's a lot more computationally efficient.
I'm surprised to see the isogrid that's still there. I thought it was supposed to be a solid cylinder.
So our analysis on that showed that it only works for modal analysis. That was the only thing that was close. I guess I want to go to the report on that. Stuff like buckling just didn't have good correlations. Modal was even like around like 14% different. So here's our modal stuff. You can see that like the blue curve, I think, is the isogrid, and then the yellow is equivalent thickness. So these track really good. You can only see that there's maybe like a 50 hertz difference at like the really short modules. Yeah. That's kind of due to an approximation that you have to have by having that kind of thick thing in there. The isogrid handbook doesn't really account for the like the extra thickness there. So that's kind of where that comes from. But stuff like buckling just doesn't line up. Like this is the isogrid with like 20,000 pounds versus like equivalent thickness at 25. And then this is for the 12 triangle pattern. If you go over to like the 24 triangle pattern, which I don't know if I have in here. Oh, that was right below it, yeah. It just doesn't hold up with like the isogrid failing at a higher load than the equivalent thickness. So anyway, that stuff doesn't track. It only tracks for modal analysis. Yeah. So I guess all the infrastructure that we developed is still useful because—
Hey, is that the optimized isogrid parameters? First buckling mode at 37.7 kips.
That is, yeah. So
that's great because the CAN calcs give like 33 or something like that. So that's fantastic.
Allegedly, this is linear buckling, which isn't exactly as robust.
Right. Did you do a RICS on that?
I did. And I think of the avionics, and that was super low at like four. This guy right here. 19,000.
Okay.
Anyway, a little bit different. Anyway, all that analysis junk is in our report here. Mm-hmm. So if anybody in the future wants to go through and see all the nitty gritty of how we did our stuff and the results, it is all in there. We got a lot of it.
It's fantastic. Will you guys talk about optimizing the isogrid since we're going to keep talking about it?
That would be Davis.
Yeah. Do you want to go to that section of the report and just look at the plots and I can talk through them real quick. So
you're good.
Actually, if you scroll up a little bit to the first three equations.
These guys?
No, N1, N2, and N3. Okay, so there's basically four ways isogrid can fail, right? These three equations we're looking at are the different buckling modes. So N1 is general instability. So that's like what you think of as like column buckling, like full length buckling. N2 is skin buckling. So that is like local buckling of an individual triangle. So you're gonna see, we've got a bunch of variables. T is our skin thickness. That's the thinnest part of the isogrid. And then N3 is rib crippling, where B is the rib width and D is the rib depth. And we have some other parameters from isogrid and some constants in there. I don't want to dig too deep into that, but essentially those are your three failure modes besides like, either your Tresca or von Mises shear or stress failures. The isogrid handbook has some pretty intense procedures for optimizing isogrid. And we kind of didn't need them because we end up having, we're more limited by our manufacturing constraints than we are by all of our variables. So what I'm going to show here is how we nailed it down. So if you scroll down to the first plot, and actually, should we talk about what these parameters represent? Do we have a picture of the of an isogrid to show that?
You had it in here somewhere, right?
Thought I did.
I don't know where that.
No, that was a mistake if I didn't include it.
No, I remember it being in there, but I don't know where. Yeah, go for it. Wait, where did I end up?
Well, okay, let's just go through this. So so basically there's, you know, the parameters we have control over are that affect these different failure modes are the thickness of the skin, rib width, rib depth, and then the triangle size, the height of an isosceles triangle, which for us is controlled by the triangle number, right? We have a cylinder, so the size of the triangle is limited by the number of triangles. The number of triangles has to wrap around our circumference. So we basically said, okay, if we had 12 triangles around the circumference, then that this is how high our triangle number is. So I use that to control. And we felt we had a strong preference for triangle numbers that go nicely into 360 degrees. So we use that as a constraint as well, so that we get nice arc lengths. But anyway, so what I did in this first plot is I modified one of those variables at a time. So you can see as triangle number increases, we get a really big increase in strength to weight. I use cross-sectional area as an analog for weight. That holds. So as we increased the rib width, we actually lost strength to weight. As we increased skin thickness, we got an increase in strength to weight, but not as efficient as increasing triangle number, and decreasing rib depth, it moves to the left from our starting point, actually gives us another increase in strength to weight. So we looked at those and said, okay, I think from this that, you know, increase in triangle number obviously give us a really drastic increase in strength to weight. Decreasing rib depth reduces weight and gives us strength to weight. So those are the two we'll control. So we left skin thickness at the minimum and rib width at the minimum per Peter's manufacturing constraints. So this next plot says, we'll control those two and we'll vary the other two. So each line in this plot is a different rib depth. And each point on a line is an increase in the number of triangles. So each of them start at 12 triangles and end at 36. So you can see as we decrease the rib depth, going from right to left, like looking at each line from right to left, each shallower rib gives us a steeper increase in strength to weight by adding more triangles. But then there's an inflection point. And so that's where the failure mode switches from general instability to skin buckling. And we found that basically we'll never fail in rib crippling. We can ignore it. And if you want to read the paper, you can learn more about that. So now we're saying, okay, there's this really good increase in strength to weight by increase in triangle number, but there's some inflection point. So that's going to be our optimal strength to weight. And then we said, okay, well, how many triangles do we want? And we think 24 is ideal. Our pass-through rings are designed at 12 triangles. And so by doing 24 triangles on the main skin, then we'll get basically every second node on the main skin lines up with one triangle on the pass-through skin, if that makes sense. So then the next plot is just finding that sweet spot. So varying the rib depth again at the 24 triangle and finding that 0.075 inch rib depth was our optimal. So we had a small increase in weight over our starting point, but we got I think this predicts like a 31 kip failure load. This gets kind of tricky because we talked about earlier how bending tests are hard to do. Bending and compression is really hard to do. So that general instability number, the starting point is that bending is at least, the stress from bending is at least 1/4 of the buckling load. So we have this nominal, the calculations predict like I think a 32 kip buckling load that assumes that about 8 kips comes from that max stress from bending. And we aren't really sure how much bending stress we're going to have. You know, the MDO has some really minimal bending stress, but I think the LV3 failure from bending kind of proves that wrong. And I think, you know, moving forward, that like I assume that what the MDO gives us for bending is wrong, and what we're going to have to do is really just keep developing the airframe, developing propulsion, and then do some air. If we really want to know what bending is going to be, we'd have to do some really complex aeroelastic CFD analysis. That's probably a master's thesis level project.
Or more, yeah.
And or we just say like, or we just say that we actually have really good resistance to based on this optimized and hope that it's strong enough.
Okay. Can you pop one of these open?
Pop one of what open?
Show us an isogrid with a pass through showing us the 24 and 12.
Yes, I will do that this way. So I guess one of the other things that just we did is we merged last year's plumbing kind of pad into our CAD as well. Just that way you can see everything.
But, you know, hide some of the notches.
Yes. Yeah, so we have a pass through up top, and then as Dave was just talking about, the nose kind of comes together from the pass through and the isogrid because we have a visible by 12.
Right.
Basically. So
that's super nice. I didn't actually understand that. Yeah. And that's good because the 24 is too small for a pass through. So
yeah.
Yes. Yeah, and we chose 12 because, again, so we get 30 degree arc lengths for each triangle. They seemed about a good size to fit a finger through. They fit the cameras in. Right now, the pass-throughs are really not optimized. Like, I ran some FEA on them, and it looks like they're strong enough. They could probably be optimized. They're a reduction in linear density over the legacy pass-throughs. Linear density meaning sort of how much weight per inch of rocket. That was sort of the metric I was going for to analyze.
If I can interject about the cameras and the pass-throughs, the way that they're mounted needs to be redesigned, and that's something that I still plan to work on. Currently, because of, Hayden, can you go back to the simulator thing? Anything with a, okay. So the skin in the back right now currently prevents the currently designed camera modules from working. So I think what I'm gonna try and do is integrate the really nicely curved angled thing so that it's part of one of the covers, as that will allow everything to work together and those can just be printed on their own without issue.
So right now in LV3, we've got the camera module and then the bulkhead, and you're just gonna integrate those into one thing. Is that what you were saying?
The best way for you to point it.
Is to point? Go ahead and point.
Point?
What
do you want me to bring up?
We have that.
Okay.
Or you can bring up something with the camera modules if you want.
Yeah, I could do camera. I guess the one like minor thing that we ended up doing is merging the avionics to camera module. Just because we could. Okay, love.
These right now are interfering with the back with the skin, and what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna make it so if you see the outline right here, with the butterfly shape,
yeah,
that's no longer gonna exist, and the rectangular section that you see here is going to be integrated into one of the notches.
Yeah, perfect.
And you just bolt it on.
Right. So those used to fit into this rectangular weird thing on LV3.
Yeah.
And then you're just making a single nacho pass through for each different camera and each different thing. That's great.
Yeah.
Okay, good. That's even better.
So I feel like we've kind of talked about the pass through. I don't know if that's clear enough that we want to skip the pass them specifically, or
we can skip it as long as you show me the inside for just a minute, which I don't think we've figured out yet. Yeah, okay, so we've not figured out quite how to put nuts there or what we're going to do with the nuts on the inside. Yeah. Okay, that's fine, that's a TBD.
Yeah, I think I should go into kind of our other like critical hardware. I was going to go for the arc clamps.
Yep.
So basically, arc clamps basically say
actually, before we move on to the arc clamps, can we talk one more thing about the nachos. I think we talked about having, I guess, two corners with a hinge and then one corner with a fastener. I guess, is that the plan in the future?
That's still the plan as far as I know, which is the idea that there's two hooks on one of the flat sides, and then on the other pointy side across from those two hooks is an actual fastener. Cool.
So our claim stayed pretty much exactly the same from last year. Same fasteners, everything like that. Literally the only thing that we changed was obviously the diameter of the rocket, which I don't know if we want to go into that.
This is a good time to do a quick talk about what happened to the diameter of the rocket.
Sure. Bigger pipe, cheaper than smaller pipe. So then we decided to go forward with that. And
well, it's pipe versus tubing, right? So
yeah.
Tubing is sized by the ID and pipe is sized by the OD, but we really care about the ID because we're machining off the OD. The pipe was a lot cheaper than tubing.
Good. So it's cheaper, wider, you know, helps with our length to diameter ratio, as well as just giving more volume inside to pack stuff in, which definitely like teams like propulsion need it. So that was kind of just a clear advantage to go with that. So I guess for clarity, all of our flight hardware and the stuff that we've made and our test infrastructure is all for the new diameter. The only thing that's at the old 12-inch diameter would be a full-scale pressure tank that Peter has. Our clamp's pretty easy. Basically, the only thing that we changed is evenly spacing the holes and then also taking off all the crap that was mounted onto it, because we thought it was super important that pretty much this clamping load be the only load that's on the air clamp, because otherwise you would have like a bunch of force from like a launch lug pushing on it, and then you could possibly have like a failure there. Especially moving to the ISO grid, it just gives us a huge opportunity to mount crap all over the rocket. Mm-hmm. That was the reason we did that. I guess the other thing we should go into real quick. Go for it.
I was going to add in there, just I think you redid the width of the channel so that we could actually manufacture those on our own, because the previous design, I think, was too narrow to actually purchase off the shelf router bits.
Yeah. So this is over an eighth inch, which is what we needed for the smallest bit at 20 degrees. So we have calculations showing like factor of safety of at least like 5 in compression and like more in tension. So they're robust. If you wanted to start hacking some weight out of it, you maybe could, but we didn't want to do that because we thought that would be sketchy. Mm-hmm. The bulkhead is what I'm going to next. Went through a pretty significant redesign. This guy we proved out pretty much exclusively through FEA. There was no ISO grid handbook calcs, just because that seemed hard. So this specific configuration right here is just to deal with some interferences that we had in the rocket, which, sorry for jumping around here, but this would be more clear to show first. We'll go into the elliptical end cap, I think, next. But basically, by having the elliptical end cap right here and then a bulkhead mounting ring right here, which those two things are just, they kind of have to be there. You have to have a bulkhead ring plus the coupling ring, and then you have to have the elliptical end cap where it is, because going any deeper would be like ungodly awful and having to buy like 3-inch long tools. To accommodate that, you have to have a little cutout in there. No analysis was done on that because I was kind of thought about it at the very last second. And we also don't really know what kind of loading this would actually see. So TBD, if another capstone wants to do that, go for it. Basically the bulkhead.
And that's a configuration.
Yeah, they are all configured. So you just switch that, and that just makes a smaller hole. This guy makes a super small hole. No hole. Yeah. And then if you want, you can also get rid of the skin, which might take a bit. But while that's loading, basically moving to ISO grid, same thing as before, get a bunch of these holes, you can mount a bunch of crap to it. And then obviously having the skin on there is really nice for stopping stuff from falling through. That's it for the bulkhead. Basically, we machined one, might break it. We'll see.
What is the number of screws and the kind of screws that hold that in?
Sure. Number 4, radially round. That was like a factor safety of 3-ish. with like the heaviest payload on here, only on this bulkhead. So you can, if you are like a smart engineer, you would have more backup systems. So yeah. ISO tank, big thing that we changed was making the end cap into an elliptical end cap.
Actually, just I think you all threw out a number the other day. How much weight on the rocket did you save by redesigning the bulkheads?
I say just redesigning the bulkheads, it was about 10 pounds saved. Redesigning the entire structure to isogrid, from the dry weight in the MDO to our current dry weight, it's like 60 pounds.
No shit.
Yeah, good stuff.
Congratulations, guys.
Yeah, so.
I mean, I don't know how well it would hold up just being held lengthwise, but a person could hold it.
Right.
It's reasonable weight.
Yeah. Yeah, it's super cool. IsoGrid is great. And IsoGrid is so great, we decided not to use it for the elliptical end cap and went with OrthoGrid instead. So OrthoGrid right here, pretty much just for weight savings. But I don't know if anybody specifically wants to talk about the elliptical end cap. Peter, I feel like you kind of had the main analysis that got us started on that. I don't know if you wanted to talk about that or... Okay.
Should I say a couple things about it?
Yeah, go for it.
Since I modeled most of it.
Sure.
So one of the things that we investigated doing, but we ended up not doing, was the OrthoGrid pockets that are on the side. We wanted to make them deeper where there's a lot of material right there. But we ended up realizing that that would both be kind of sketchy with how everything else is here, because it's going to be pressurized, and the tooling required for that is not really amazing to have to deal with. So we decided against doing that. And then elliptical this term, because when it wasn't elliptical, it became elliptical on here. So hopefully making it elliptical stops that from happening more.
When you guys did your hydrostatic test, was that the elliptical end cap?
It was, yeah.
It was.
It didn't have the elliptical.
Didn't have the elliptical, yeah. But
so yeah, we did finish the elliptical test.
Go ahead.
Teresa and I did get that small tank tested with the elliptical. We didn't do it to the final factor of safety, but we did get it to its mean operating pressure.
So we did FEA on this at 270 PSI. And I was like factor safety 1.5-ish, I think.
Yeah.
And then also we looked at like the thermal effects of like having it contract, and we found that like the arc clamps didn't interfere. Either of you guys want to say, Brandon and Rebecca were our end cap FEA people. So I don't know if you guys have anything specific to add, but that was that. Yeah. It's in the report.
Yeah.
Oh, make sure you read it. Yeah. I think that's like the big changes we made to the rocket. Obviously, having to redo the cab, we did a lot of things, like I said, with configuration. So a lot of the parts are like super interchangeable and they're very parametric, wherever they are. The race pipes, even, those were modeled as individual parts last year. So we just modeled it as like one part with varying lengths. Fin brackets, I guess we should say, are like super, super preliminary. And based off of the added length from ERS, we probably might want to take a look at like center of pressure versus center of gravity type stuff and see if anything has to change there.
Well, Peter's idea to add drop-off fins, stage the fins, is going to change that whole thing. So it's good that you guys didn't touch that much.
Yeah. Yeah.
Zoom out for a second, kind of zoom in and start from the very top and just kind of pan down.
Sure. So this whole module here is ERS. That was kind of modeled based off of their current design, current length. Right here, we integrated RCS, N2, and all the NC plumbing into one single module. Right. So that guy ended up being really long. So I don't know if that would be a problem to work with. Might want to consider that in the future. We merged the avionics and camera module into one single module. We're calling this the upper plumbing module that just sits above the IPA tank. That's that. And so there's a pass through at the top and bottom. We chose not to have a bulkhead ring between the pass-through and the ISO grid, but there's a configuration that just flip a switch and then you can have that in there if you want. And obviously we have our ISO tank, the top one. And so we have the local end cap and the ISO grid, model the weld in there to just have a little weld flange. That's that. Then this guy is the lower plumbing. I hid some stuff in there, but there's plumbing in there, believe me. there's the LOX tank. And then we have the fin fan module down there. And so all of our links were basically just justified off of making sure that all the plumbing from last year would actually fit in there, and as well as just any other kind of oddball stuff like ERS that we just have laying around. So that's the rocket. I don't know if anybody has any specific questions before we move on to the test infrastructure. No? Okay. We kind of went over this on the poster. There honestly isn't that much more to it. But basically, there's a hydraulic ram that sits on the inside. There's loads, I can show you. Hydraulic ram that sits on the inside, load cell that sits up top. So load cell right up here, and then hydraulic ram right down there. A little cutout right here to feed in your hydraulic line. And then basically it's just a bunch of cylinders stacked on top of each other to add space. These guys are the coupling rings that the arc clamps stick to. And then we have these big giant grade 8, 3/8 inch bolts to stop everything from shooting. And that's basically that. You can flip out your arc clamps. I think at the very beginning, we mentioned you can put a whole module in there if you want. And then also you can replace that upper plate with whatever you wanna bend. That's that whole kind of assembly really quick.
That's great.
Yeah.
And Peter, what's the current status of that?
I'm sick.
That's a good status.
So the top and bottom of the hat box are made. There's one of the arc clamp rings that is complete. I did make a second arc clamp ring, but it didn't quite meet the tolerances we needed. I tried clamping them together and it wouldn't interface quite right there. It actually snugs in there, but it won't actually apply the force in the proper location. I'm going to make another one of those, hopefully soon, and then, move on to the plates and the inside coupling rings.
Good.
I guess one last little thing I wanted to mention that we went into is, with the equivalent thickness, we kind of took that, and since that auto-generates, you can make a model. We have a whole folder here of the different analysis tools that we made that just kind of auto-generates. So this is like equivalent shell thickness of the entire rocket generated from the same parametric models. So like, you know, generates the IPA tank, generates all the ISO grid modules and stuff. So then you can pull that into FEA, and then you can do, make your rocket noodle and bend and stuff like that, which see all the modes and stuff like that. Yeah, so there's that. We also made one for CFD, which is a solid model, and then just a simplified FEA one if you want to do like really, really simplified stuff. Anyway, all the specific analysis is in the report, but those are just some tools there that are generated easily. So I think that's what we did. Yeah.
Not much.
So I think it'd be good to cover our recommendations for the future teams, which I know we've kind of touched on here and there.
One before we do that, let's go through your Google Drive folder.
Don't do it. Run.
Oh, you know what? You know what we didn't talk about? We didn't talk about the ISOGRID sample compression test.
We could touch on that like super quick. So we did a compression test.
You should pull it up on the paper.
Which one is that? Yours? 15? There we go. Do you have the comparison? So basically, Peter made us a little sample. It was at a scale 6-inch size, but you know, ISOGRID parameters before the auto leveling technique that Peter has. So we found significant manufacturing deviations within the skin thickness, and that caused it to fail a lot sooner than like hand counts and FEA predicted. But doing a refined FEA basically off of some different skin parameters, we found that it failed like right at 7.2 kips, which was like a 2% deviation from the actual.
That's amazing.
So that's great. And so the analysis tools are obviously still around. You should be able to do that with every single test that we do. Since we didn't really explore tension, we can't speak on that, but likely you could do the same thing for tension and see the same correlation.
I will add that even with those manufacturing defects, it still failed at about the same strength as the carbon fiber.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Okay. So Brandon and Davis, I don't know if you guys want to throw anything else on there since you guys did this specific section of the report, but
No, I think you covered it.
Cool. Yeah.
So go back to Google Drive.
Google Drive.
Yep. And do me a favor, in the upper right hand corner, hit the little buttons. Yep, that one. Thank you. Go back up a frame.
Sure.
Up a level.
Up a level, sure.
So in LV4, systems LV4 airframe is 2021-2022 LV4. Capstone, if you go in there.
Wait, this one?
Nope, the ears.
Okay.
That one, yes.
Yeah.
Don't care about that one.
Yeah.
Okay, in going to 491 reports.
Sure.
So that's all of your guys' stuff that you need to do for 491, including the, I assume, the poster and is the final report in here? Yes.
Down there, and there's also a PDF version in the one level above it.
Excellent, good. All right.
Cool.
And then go back up. CFD.
Abby Davis.
So I did this for my CFD class, and the goal was to get a sense of what drag would look like on the funnel rocket. So I used an older version of the rocket, and it's sort of simple analysis. And I wanted to be able to investigate it at different angles of attack and try to get center of pressure out of it. And I think it can do that. I never went that far with it, but I wrote up my modeling procedures in there. And
is there a reason why there's a copy there?
I don't know. Maybe that's a later version.
Oh, that was me. Sorry. You can delete one of those.
Okay, yeah, delete it.
I was trying to do something.
Thanks. Okay, good.
Cool.
FEA subsystems.
Sure. So all these are different subsystems that we did FEA on. Within each of these folders, you have the CAE file, which is basically what you throw into Abacus.
Awesome.
And we also have some reports for the FEA, which most of these have individual reports.
You got my, yeah.
Yeah.
This one, because the analysis took so long, Abacus keeps the, files after you run the results, they keep in like a temporary folder that eventually gets deleted. So these are all the done results, so you don't have to like try and load it again.
So the ODB files are what you're interested in. You basically just take the ODB file and you open it up in Abacus, yeah. And then you can see the plots and all the
awesome stuff. This is all advocacy stuff, okay?
All advocacy stuff.
So all the CAE files, you'd have to rerun your analysis. Yeah.
But everything is set up. So with all of our CAE files, the jobs are created. So if you are in the future and you want to see what we did, and you don't have the output file, just go open it up. You got to have something that has a lot of licenses. So like the personal license doesn't have to be on the school license. Anyway, you just go in there and you click run and then wait like a day or two and then it'll be done.
Well, in the year 2023, you know, we'll have fast computers. So
yeah,
that's right.
Nice.
All right.
So yeah, we'll uncap. We did some thermal analysis as well as stress analysis. So both of those are in there. Stuff like the full airframe, that was modal analysis that I did. And then we also have a preliminary thermal model. If you want to investigate that, we didn't have time to like go deep into that, but the equivalent weight thickness should work for that if you want to figure out your temperature distribution and stuff. Full-scale ISO module, this is like comparing the 24 triangles versus like the equivalent thickness. What else we got here? Ice grid bulkhead, that's the bulkhead. Ice grid module, that would be like the test module. Pass-through would be the pass-through, obviously. LOX module was kind of like the thermal stress as well as just regular stress FEA. And the old bulkhead, that's kind of iffy. Read at your own risk. I don't know. That was when I was first doing FEA. And then the test infrastructure, that was basically just sizing the giant ass inch thick 7075 plate. So that's that.
Yeah. The MCAP also has a couple of different things within it.
Cool. Hand counts. Yeah, I don't think this folder is really that fleshed out, but we have some write-ups as well as some of this stuff. Most of our analysis is on GitHub, so putting the notebook files in here. Yeah. So write-ups on that. Manufacturing. I don't have my manufacturing file in there. I will do that right after this. I have the master cam file for making the bulkhead.
Thank you. Someone take notes for this kind of thing. I want to make sure that we don't miss that.
I got that. Okay. I just got to upload one file. I'm on it.
All right.
Fail me if we don't. Yeah. Media. This is a lot of stuff that we did for our video. So we, Becca, I don't know if that's specifically talk about this, since you probably organized stuff.
No, we just have the raw footage from our winter term, everything we did winter term, and then at the top is the finalized video. So
yeah,
a little summary of winter term.
Okay, so that's the summary of winter term. Do you guys have a video for spring term?
I'm editing it. Right,
in progress. Now. Okay. The raw footage is Google Drive links. I was about to upload up. It's in my drive.
Okay.
Upload something else.
Once the file edited thing is done, you feel free to kill the raw footage.
Okay.
I don't think we need it.
Sure.
Unless you think there's something special about it, then we should leave it. But I think that edited this stuff is good.
There's cool. A lot of funny things in it.
We got some Gantt charts in here. I stole Katie's Gantt chart. I recommend anybody steal my Gantt chart to steal Katie's Gantt chart. You know, so it's like telephone. You know, eventually this gets distorted. You know. Exactly. And then just a few other things like the bomb, our notes. We did a little inventory of what we had laying around, like deposit stuff. Design choices basically got summarized in the reports. I don't know if we really need that, but
that's fine.
Yeah, that's basically. And then there's a report for you all.
Surprise requirements only that feature view. Oh, yeah. I read.
How many
official pages?
Like, how many
total?
231. Ike was like 300, but yeah, no, this is real. There's like
why Ike says 300?
Ike's was 300.
Ike's what
report back when he was
whatever,
you know. His company's also ran out of business.
We went crazy on the documentation,
which is fantastic. That's exactly what you should have done.
So. We would love to answer questions, but please read the report first. But yeah, there's stuff all over there. So yeah. That was our capstone.
Open up GitHub. You guys had some stuff on GitHub?
Like minimal, but sure.
Yeah, just open it up anyway.
So IsoTank, I think Davis, if you want to specifically talk about this, this is what you did. You did the IsoGrid parametric and the IsoGrid module, right?
Yes, but I basically, that was in trying to investigate some of the failure modes, and I basically recreated in that Excel file, which the Excel file that I used to generate those plots when I was talking about optimization. That Excel file is in the drive. And I would just use that instead. But yeah, I was just trying to come up with a way to, this is based off the notebook that Peter made for the propellant tanks, and I modified it for the non-pressurized skin.
I don't know how to fix this, but this is the same thing. I don't know if this was the scale 6-inch model or if this is the 12-inch model. Peter did one of those, Davis did the other. Basically Davis's version got redone in the Excel spreadsheet. Airframe, just a few little things that were in here was like IsoGrid bulkhead, fastener analysis. I think we did the arc clamp. Peter mostly did the arc clamp hand calcs in there. And then I tried doing hand calcs on buckling, which just kind of didn't work out compared to FEA. But a few things like checking out the equivalent mass thickness versus like CAD mass and moment of inertia versus CAD moment of inertia are in there, which are useful. But yeah, that's it.
I have a question.
Yes.
Can you talk about how they figured that out? Or did they get on
the... I can't hear the question. What was the question?
Zach was wondering how they figured out equivalent thickness.
So, I mean, I would encourage you, if you're interested, to read the IceGrid handbook. There's a couple of different, there's like equivalent weight thickness, there's an equivalent monocoque thickness, which predicts like deflection and sort of stress of the, if you treat it as a membrane, the membrane stresses. But it's, okay. Yeah, they do work through those calculations in the handbook. It's a dense read, and it took me a long time to figure out how to understand it and use it.
You want a real quick overview of why we don't think it works for buckling is because of the three different failure modes that we talked about, with like rib crippling, skin buckling, and then general instability. You have all of that modeled in FEA by like actually having skin and ribs and all that kind of stuff. But if you go to equivalent thickness, it's just one cylinder. And right. So then you lose your three different failure modes.
So one of the one of the advantages of IceGrid, so it does give you an increase in like compressive strength, but it gives you actually a much bigger increase in bending strength. So like, and when you think about buckling, it's the main variables are radius of gyration, if you recall that from strength of materials, and your moment of inertia, and the sort of helical pattern gives you a really big improvement to your radius of gyration. So it's hard to capture that because it in as modeling as a solid cylinder, because you don't get how those features give you improved resistance to bending, and that gives you a better buckling resistance. That's the quick answer. I'm happy to go into more detail on that later if you want to discuss it after the
meeting. No, I'm going to cut you guys off. You're going long.
After the meeting. Else.
Well, okay.
Yeah.
That's it, huh?
You asked for part write-ups. So we kind of have subsystem write-ups in here, which basically fulfill our part write-ups.
Yeah, that's perfect.
So, yeah.
But guys, this is fan-fucking-tastic.
And can I just add, so when the two capstones wrapped up last year, we had a lot of weight increase, primarily just the propulsion system. Our early estimates were really low on weight. And I think we, at the end of last year, we needed a 16 kilonewton engine in order to get to the von Karman line. I think Aaron has updated the latest MDO with the airframe results, and now we're down to about a 10 kilonewton engine. So we've still got a little ways to go, but that's a huge improvement.
Awesome.
Yeah, that's almost on the borderline of doable now. That's great. So congratulations. Also, I want to thank you guys for pushing the IceGrid as opposed to the composite. As much as we love the composite and we love LV3 and we love what that did for us, this feels more PSASSy. This feels more like that we can do it in-house, and that it's cheaper with quotes, and that we can make more of these, and they're reproducible and all that kind of stuff. I really feel like this is it.
So, and I don't think any other university rocket teams are doing this.
Yeah,
not that I know of.
Yeah,
I don't know if you've seen Space Concordia's rocket. It is a massive piece of stainless steel pipe. It's heavy.
It's awesome. So that they just launched, didn't they? Someone just launched a massive piece of stainless steel pipe. I don't know where Purdue, thank you. Yeah. Okay. Thank you, guys. Congratulations. You're done.
Wow.
Is the ERS handoff on the same Zoom, or is it a different
link? I'm going to go ahead and stop the recording. Oh, there's a chat. Joe. All right.